Well, if you have an outline today, we're looking at the whole idea of patience. And the key question that we're looking at today is, how does God provide the help I need to deal with stress? Often when we're stressed out, our patience starts to get somewhat stretched. And the key idea that we want to look at today is, I'm slow to anger, and I'll endure patiently under the unavoidable pressures of life. Isn't it funny how when we're impatient, anger becomes one of the key emotions that we express? But when we're patient, we're slow to anger. We're long-suffering. You know, speaking of patience, I came across this story about, get ready, a priest, a doctor, and an engineer who were waiting one morning for a particularly slow group of golfers. The engineer asked, "What's with these guys? We've just been waiting for them for 15 minutes to get play through their hole." And the doctor agreed, "I've never seen such slow golfers." And the pastor noted, "Well, here comes the groundskeeper. Let's have a word with him. Maybe we can find out what's going on." The pastor, you know, always the peacemaker. The pastor called out to the groundskeeper, "Say, George, what's going on with the group ahead of us? Why are they playing so slow?" And George said, "Well, that's a group of blind firefighters. They lost their sight saving our golf clubhouse from fire last year. So anytime they show up, we let them play for free." Well, the group was silent for a moment. The pastor sympathized. "That's so sad. I think I'll keep them in my prayers tonight." The doctor added, "That's a good idea. In fact, I'm going to contact my ophthalmologist buddy and see if we can do anything for these great bunch of guys." Then the engineer spoke up. "Well, that's great, but in the meantime, why can't these guys play at night?" See? You know, I grew up in a time, and for those of you who can remember this, you remember the Heinz ketchup glass bottle? Remember the torture it was waiting to dress your hamburger or french fries or hot dog as you watched the ketchup slowly leave the bottle? Now, I know for you younger people, now you have the plastic squeeze bottles that are destroying our environment and the pump actions, but we had the glass bottle. And that is where I began to learn about patience. You know, the key verse for today in your outline is, "Whoever is patient has great understanding, but one who is quick-tempered displays folly." You know, this is from the wisdom literature of Scripture, and here they're making a comparison between the foolishness of short-tempered people who make quick and rash decisions as opposed to the patient or the person who, instead of having a short temper, has a long temper to become angry. And by avoiding that hurtful, harsh, and rash reactions of a short temper, because they're practicing patience, they have space to gain greater understanding, see what's going on, appreciate more what's happening, understand all the dynamics, and because of that, they gain great understanding. You know, I got thinking about the wisdom of this saying. Can you look back on a situation in your life where instead of enduring and persevering and patiently working through something, you simply reacted with a measure of anger, only to regret that impatient decision for months, if not years, to come? Parents, haven't you noticed that when you're patient with your children, middle schoolers, high schoolers, young adults, that you actually do know in the long run you achieve far more with them than frustrating them with your impatient demands to perform and excel? Well, today we're going to consider the quality of patience that we're called to live out as followers of Christ. In fact, Scriptures tell us that we are to clothe ourselves with loving qualities that include patience. Paul says this in Colossians. He says, "Clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience." When it comes to faith fashions, patience is always a timeless look. You know, we may see the value of patience as a virtue worth practicing in our lives, but patience is bigger than that. We must see that patience starts with God. It's God's divine disposition with us. You know, one commentator describes the patience of God. He says it's one of his attributes that runs through the Old Testament like a refrain. One of the classic statements is when God met Moses and he said, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Can't you just hear the patience being revealed? God's patience, as we read through the Old Testament and New Testament, is an outstanding example of this virtue. Though Israel turns to idols and wickedness, God pleads with them to repent and call upon his name. He tells Solomon, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. And so God is patient. He waits. He sends his prophets for generation after generation before finally exiling Israel and Judah to foreign lands. And as Nehemiah prays, for many years, Lord, you were patient with them, but by your spirit you admonished them through your prophets. Now, this is God revealing himself, and the quality of patience is described in his divine revelation. You know, this means patience goes beyond just, well, it's common sense to show some patience in the moment. It takes patience to a whole new level. The scriptures tell us that we who are his dear children are to imitate God in everything we do. So the patience of God serves as the source and the pattern for our human patience. Our patience is rooted in the patience of God. And patience, if we're honest, is part of the big journey of being an apprentice or a disciple of Christ. But let's just pause the button for a moment. You say, yes, Dave, patience, it's wonderful. Patience, it's a great quality. Yes, we need to learn that. But let's just look at our outline here. Patience is a pain. Let's be honest. Patience is a pain. You know, I want it now. I was just looking at a new ad by Bell Alliant, where they say, now it's 2 times faster. You know, the internet you can have on your phone can be 2 times faster from the 4 times faster from the year before and the 8 times faster from 10 years ago. Because it's fast. You got to click the button. It's got to be there. Now, go. Let's be honest. Our technology has made us impatient. I think about all you millennials down there. Yes, I'm looking at you. Not looking at you. You're not millennial. No, I'm looking at you. I think of Generation Z. You are so used to everything instantaneously. You really are. You don't even now have to wait week after week for a show. You can just go to Netflix and binge watch the whole thing. Why put up with waiting for 4 months for a show? We live in a time of speed. We have access to instant information with instant made food to chow along as well. You know, here's another reason why patience is a pain. It's because people drive me crazy. Let's be honest. Do you find people drive you crazy? Just think about the people you're going to go to work with tomorrow. Think about the kids you're going to hang out with school tomorrow. Think about the one you're married to. Think about the one you are falling in love with. And you're saying, oh, no, I can change him. No, you can't. I mean, why is it, let's honestly, why is sometimes being part of a church family hard? Because people drive you crazy. You got involved in a ministry, and that other person on your ministry team would just not be quiet. Yak, 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 yak. You know, people in our neighborhoods, in our churches, in our communities, are manipulative, they're fickle, they're foolish. I mean, it's so easy to rationalize our impatience with others. If they could just be like me. If they could just get their act together, just like me. You know, we far too often expect others to act now how we want them to act. And if they disappoint us or let us down, we are so fragile in our emotional health, we go, I'm out of here. Can't put up with this anymore. But behind all that patience being a pain, let's be honest too, there's another one that's, I think, far more deeper than behind it all. We think God is too slow. Behind all our frustration with life circumstances and people in our lives is rooted in thinking that God just doesn't move fast enough. We struggle to trust his timetable. We struggle to believe that if God really is at work in our lives, why don't we see God acting right now? I prayed, didn't I? Heck, I prayed for a week. I mean, I've been going to church now for the last 3 Sundays. I mean, come on, God. Make things happen. Make those changes in our lives. And what happens so often is once we see God not working the way we think he should work, well, then we put God aside and we take it upon ourselves. You know, there's nothing new about our impatience with God. It's as old as the Old Testament. When God was delivering the people of Israel from Egypt, rather than thanking God for the food he was giving them, the manna and the, you know, from heaven, and their freedom from slavery, and his visible presence, remember, he traveled with them by cloud and by fire in the wilderness. Guess what they did? They grumbled and complained. Why? Because they felt the route they were to get to the promised land was taking too long. They were impatient. They just been to, like, the Red Sea. But come on, God. You've left us out in the wilderness here to die. And here is actually where we see impatience is shown for what it is. It's selfish, whining, demanding. And the self is placed above God's purposes and demands its desires be met immediately rather than according to God's perfect plan. So let's take the last of the time remaining this morning and just do a little bit of a deeper dive of saying, okay, if I'm supposed to be clothing myself with patience, that's supposed to be one of the qualities in my life as a disciple of Christ. What does that look like? Well, I want to suggest to you that there are two sides of patience. There's a working side to patience, an active side to patience, and a waiting side. You know, in fact, as we were going through this together, as Brent Hudson, our teaching pastor, and actually Micah is preaching this very same message over at Riverview Baptist Church today because Mark Smith, the interim pastor there, is gone, and it's another brick in the wall for us as we continue our dating journey with them. We were sitting down talking about this, and we discovered that there's actually 4 Greek words in the New Testament that all could be translated as patience, or a derivative of patience, like endurance or steadfastness or long-suffering. And we said, well, that's really cool. There's actually 4 words to describe our one big idea today. So we said, well, let's just at least highlight this, because if you can kind of at least get your head, and you don't have to memorize it, just take the outline home and put it on your fridge and say, these are the qualities of patience in my life. Let's just take a look at them quickly. See, the first side of patience, we say, is where we need to work, where we need to be active. And the 2 words there that you need to keep in mind about this part of patience is this. It means to bear it, and keep going. Ephesians 4:2 says this, bearing with one another in love. You know, the idea of bearing it up with someone is to hold up, to stand erect. You do not sit down in the midst of adversity. It's interesting that this is connected with love, that you are going to bear it up in a way to express your love for others. Do you know that we love others by holding them up in times of struggle? That when we endure through the hard times with others, when we bear it up, we're showing patience. But that means we have to be actively involved. We can't check out. We can't leave. I think of a song, I'm Going to Stand by You, is a powerful and loving way to express that bearing up. You know, we come to the other word about keep going. We not only bear it, but we keep going. We keep moving. In Hebrews 11:27, it says, he, which was describing Moses in this verse, kept right on going. And the force of this word is it means to do something persistently in the face of opposition. Let's be honest. At times when we lose our patience is when we try to move forward on something within our relationships, within projects, within whatever. And guess what? We face resistance. We face opposition. Guess what? We press in. We press on. You know, this verse refers to Moses not afraid of the Pharaoh's wrath, but kept moving forward in what God wanted him to do, regardless of the resistance he was going to meet. And he did meet resistance. Now ask yourself, what areas of resistance are you facing right now where you need to patiently keep going? You know, there's the other side of patience, though. So there is bear it and keep going. Well, now let's look at the other side. And this side is about waiting. And in the waiting, we are called to perseverance and patience. In 2 Thessalonians 1:4, Paul writes, "We boast about your perseverance." Paul's describing how early believers stood their ground in the midst of life's difficulties. Rather than remove oneself from adversity, one stays put. It speaks of a courage to stay in it rather than run away. Isn't it when it's hard, right? You just want to flee. The other key word here, though, is patience itself. We could have translated it long suffering, but that's not a word we often use today. Unless you maybe say to your children, "Today I'm going to practice long suffering." Long suffering with you. Maybe we need to bring it back. You know, the last word for patience here is about being long-tempered, not short-tempered. You know, Jesus demonstrated this with all he met, especially in times of suffering and persecution. When you read the account of the Passion, when he was going to trial and to the cross, look, you can see the patience right within that story. He yielded to arrest without resistance. And when he was being mocked and scorned in the trials he was facing, he did not return scorn for scorn or threat for threat at his trial, even though he had it within his means to call down a legion of angels. See, Jesus demonstrated at the heart of patience is that instead of hasty action and anger, we are willing to trust God, especially in the midst of troubles and trials, that God will keep his promises. We are willing to wait in God's time. You know, I think that when we think about this last idea of waiting on God and being long-tempered in the midst of the difficult moments, I think about how we need to think about how Christ has been patient with us. He has had a long temper with us. Paul understood this. Paul said, "But God had mercy on me so that Jesus Christ could use me as a prime example," now catch this, "of his great patience with even the worst sinners. The others will realize that too, and they can believe and receive eternal life." So in the midst of trying times, we stay patient and work, doing what we can, standing with others in love, bearing with them. Will we be willing to keep going and moving ahead? And in the midst of adversity, the question is, will you wait? Will we be willing to persevere by courageously staying our ground? Will we wait on God, trusting that God is at work when there's nothing we can do but wait? And we will say, we will not lash out in anger or seek revenge, but leave it in God's hands. But you're saying, "Dave, patience is actually really hard to do. It's hard to be patient. It hurts." And I guess that's the hard news when we speak of learning patience in God and with others. I'm convinced that it does involve a measure of soul pain and frustration and anger, that we have to know that those emotions are bubbling up within us. But as they say, no pain, no gain. And there's a great reward to patience, because here's the two things that as you clothe yourself with patience, this is how your life will become deeper and more rooted in God. The first thing you'll start to say is, "I'm trusting that God is at work." You know, the growth of my spiritual walk with God is measured to a very great extent in my patience. Our temptation is too often to think that I'm the one in control of my life. And when we begin to see how we're powerless over so much, the more I start to know God's grace and presence, I'm going to stop trying to be the manager, but simply be a laborer in God's work, where I simply get up each day and say, "Lord, what is it that we're about today in your world and in your kingdom that's coming? How do you want me to do your will and your way within my family, within my friendships, within my neighborhood, within my job? And God, if there are blocks and resistance, grant me wisdom, grant me strength, but I'm not going to freak out. Why? Because it's in your hands, Lord. I know that you're at work. You know, often in the midst of the pain of either impatience or patience, and pain comes both ways, we're faced with the choice to let go and believe that God is at work even when so much seems not to be working. It doesn't mean we'll not feel sorrow or concern, nor am I saying I'm asking you to passively resign yourself in some sort of fatalistic way that's devoid of feeling and passion. I think we can still have a very passionate, caring patience, but we will wait upon the Lord. We will renew our strength in him. And like Abraham of old, waiting for the promise of his son to be born, scriptures say Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, his faith grew stronger, and this he brought glory to God. I am convinced that patience is a quiet revelation about where our faith in God really is. How patient are you? You know, that brings us, though, to that next part in us understanding, letting patience really do its work in us and clothing ourselves. We will come to that place of patience where we'll say, I'm trusting that God's at work. But the second thing that we will say, though, too, is, but I will still do my part. I will do my part. You know, as I think about the work and ministry God calls me to do, as I think about the work and ministry God calls you to do, whether that's in your studies, whether that's with your job, with your family, with your friends, in the church, in the greater community, let me help you take a moment and just think about what does it mean to do patient work or patiently work. I think patient work in the midst of waiting includes these things. You still show up. You just show up. Well, you're saying, well, nothing's been happening, so why bother showing up? Well, you see, you're patient. You're waiting for something to happen. You speak words of encouragement. When people are saying, nothing's happening, we got to move faster, you got to say, well, wait a minute. What else can we see here that God's doing? I think we need to, in the midst of our patient work, we need to be listening for God's voice in others. I think we need to pay attention to what is right in front of us. Sometimes in our impatience, we're so looking out there that we're not paying attention to what's right here. I think patient work is praying for strength and wisdom. I think patient work is serving in small ways while waiting for the big moment. I think patient work is staying with others and standing next to one another and bearing each other up in love. I think patient work includes worship. I think of the story of Paul and Barnabas, you know, thrown into prison. And while they were in shackles, what did they do? They sang. I think singing is part of our patient work. We remind ourselves of where our hope really lies. But can I tell you the greatest work of patience we can do while we wait? So what can we be doing while we're waiting? I call it simply one word. It's love. One of the most influential teachers in my life, sort of from a distance, I only got to listen to him at a couple of different conferences, but I always listened to so many of his sermons, was the late Dr. Haddon Robinson. He died this past summer. Incredible communicator. He was one time talking about 1 Corinthians 13, about the love chapter, and he made a very interesting point. He says, the Apostle Paul in this chapter 13 of the love chapter demonstrates what love is by what love does. I love that. What love is by what love does. And then he starts to describe what love does. And the very first thing he says is love is. And guess, what do you think he writes? Love is patient. See, you just learned another Bible verse today. That's incredible. Love is patient. Very first description. I think Paul knew this in his pastoral ministries when he thought about the churches that he planted and worked with, the communities of faith, just like this community of faith that we're in. Look what he writes to some of these churches. He says, "Brothers and sisters, we urge you to warn those who are lazy. Encourage those who are timid. Take tender care of those who are weak." But then he sums it all up. Be patient with everyone. And then he's talking to his young protege, Timothy. And he says, "Preach the word, Timothy. Be prepared, whether the time is favorable or not." And then he says, "Patiently correct. Patiently rebuke. Patiently encourage your people with good teaching." I know in all the years I've been pastoring, I know I'm going off the rails from what God wants me to be as a pastor, as your pastor, when I find myself going into meetings impatient, and my voice is harsh, and I'm unforgiving, and there's a tinge of both cynical sarcasm and anger just underneath the surface of my words. I know I'm going off the rails. And when I start to become demanding of others, you see, I'm thinking to myself, I got this great dream for the next generation ministries. I think we got way more than enough resources for everybody to help us hit the 400 bricks. Why aren't we at the... See, I could go there. Instead of saying, "God, I'm going to trust that you're going to just do the work that you've called to do. All I'm called to do is tell the need and hopefully communicate it well and paint a vision of the difference we could make in the next generations and the lives that we could change in the years to come as we invest in that and grow in generosity and love and let that be part of our legacy." Now, I'm thinking, that's all I can do. So, God, I'm trusting that you're at work. I've done my part. And now we're just going to patiently wait. And we're starting to see things grow. You know, patience is listed among the fruits of the Holy Spirit indwelling my life. That means it's, first of all, not a virtue to be achieved, but a gift received. And when patience comes, it comes into me only when I depend upon God's power within me to be patient. But along with that gift, that empowerment of God, patience is also an obligation. We are called to clothe ourselves with patience. You know, Jesus told a story about seeds falling on different people's hearts, and he talked about our hearts like soil. And here, listen to this last part of the story, he said, "And the seeds that fell on the good soil represent honest, good-hearted people who hear God's word, cling to it." And I love this next phrase. "And patiently produce a harvest." What's God going to do in the next year in your life? What's God going to do in the next 5 years in your family's life? What's God going to do in the next 10 years in the Journey Church's family's life? Will you be patient enough to hang in, bear up, keep going, and persevere? Well, I want to end at this moment, before we take up the offering, with just an illustration. One of my favorite animated cartoon movies I always liked was Prince of Egypt. Story about Joseph. And in it, he's in prison now. He's been falsely accused, and he doesn't know what's going to happen next, except he's holding on to that God's going to do something, but he has to be patient. You know, Joseph is a prototype of Christ. He prefigures Christ, but he also is an example for us in our faith. So let's just listen to this song and see how he both waits and works as he patiently trusts God.
I thought I did what's right. I thought I had the answers. I thought I chose the surest road, but that road brought me here. So I put up a fight and told you how to help me. Now just when I have given up, the truth is coming clear. You see the reason, but maybe knowing I don't know is part of getting through. I try to do what's best, and faith has made it easy to see the best thing I can do is put my trust in you, for you.